start asking. And start stand up. Don't be squeezed. You're a big man. Why are you okay, I think we never know. This is the first challenge. I keep taking things off. You didn't stop. Right? You tell me stop, huh? Okay, boy. Yeah, first question. Ask anything. That's a good question. It's good. So when you found it, some relief, did you think you would ever become this big an organization? Obviously, you could never be big enough.
There's no end to your story, and there's no end for the first step that you take on the road. But you know that you want to reach the end of it, but you don't know when, how, but you know why. Why you make the first step? Because you know it. I did not have this answer at the time, and I do not have it this time. Because it's a never-ending story. If you know why, your heart on the why you're doing it, Allah will be pushing you. Allah will become your eyes, ear, and your power. Because you know why. And you clean your heart.
Should I take my jacket off?
Okay. I force you to take it off. Thank you. Pause.
Question from sister?
Yes. Can you raise your voice? How can she practically help the Syrian refugees? What specialty you have?
Sorry?
What specialty you have?
Marketing? Yeah.
Good. This is your specialty. But before the specialty, you have to find a way in your mind. So, you want to do it, and you will do it. If you believe something, you can change it. So, marketing with the social media, was recording something, you have to spread the issue, the humanitarian issue. And then, because people still up till now don't know how those people are suffering. Okay? You have to keep going on. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Ma'un, وَلَا يَحُبْدُ عَلَىٰ keep advocating. Keep spreading the news. Don't keep asking people for money. Okay? Keep advocating, keep spreading the news. Keep the momentum going with your friends, with your colleagues, with anybody else. When you put something on your Facebook, okay, or your Twitter, and how many thousands of people can see it? How many hundreds of people can see it? And this is what you need to do. Use your skills to spread your message. Paul.
Come! Are you still involved? Are you still starting?
I'm still involved in many organizations, not only Islamic community. No, not hands-on. Because at some time of your life, you're hands-on. When I was at the 30s and 40s and 50s, till I finished the 50s, okay, I was hands-on. Now I'm in the 60s. I'm not hands-on, what do you call it? Minds-on or brains-on. Okay, now I'm thinking. Use my knowledge and use my experience and share it with others. That's why 2 days ago I was with Human Appeal in Birmingham with the volunteers of Human Appeal. Okay. Before that I was with Muslim Hand. I was with Ithar Relief. I was with everybody. Because now when you become expert in your field, use the knowledge to let the people to rise. And I want you to use your knowledge and your expertise and your heart to maintain this humanitarian movement. Thank you. Yes, sir, come on.
Are you feeling cold?
Come on.
Are you feeling cold?
With you not. Because you are encouraging me. See, can I take a photo of them? Question? Okay, fine, thank you. Question, yes, please.
Thank you.
You inspire me. Stand up.
Like,
Stand up and face the wind. Don't break the wind, but face it.
And my question is to do with us volunteers. I mean, we take a lot of time out to sort of do challenges such as these. And Zeeshan mentioned that whenever he sort of feels demotivated or needs a sort of kick up the backside, as he says, he speaks to you. I mean, a lot of us may not have that privilege to be able to speak to you all the time. So what's the one message that you would give to us that we can take away from today and refer back to whenever we feel low, and sort of to help us, give us that push as well in the future?
We always feel low. But when you feel low, go back to Allah. Read the Quran. If you cannot read the Quran, listen to it. Somebody reciting the Quran. Okay, this is one, number one. Number two, perform your personal duty as a Muslim to keep you up. Okay? Number three, mix with the poor people. Whenever you mix with the poor people and you feel low, you feel that actually a privilege of having what you have. Okay? You might go to the next door neighbor or somebody who has or go to the hospital and visit the sick and thank Allah for giving him or giving you this health. I'm talking about boys and girls, men and women. Go to the graveyard and say, this is my ultimate house. Okay? My life ended before I went to this place. And I'll be there. How can I prepare myself? Travel. See other people. Go with Islamic Relief or other organizations to the field. To be empowered. To be inspired. To be motivated. Not by ex-man like myself, but by this little miserably looking young boy or girl who's naked, hungry, and thirsty, and greet you with a smile. Because you can see the hope in your vision. You go back, reform it 180 degrees. There's many ways of it, but don't stop listening to the Quran if you cannot read it. I'm not saying it's complete, but sometimes it's difficult to read it in Arabic. Listen to it. Because listening to the Quran is nur in your heart, and nur is light, and nur in your face. Reading it is a higher reward. Do either, or both. Okay? Now you feel cold.
Sure. No, I'm okay.
Very good. Pause, please.
Where's the refugee?
Why you are where's out.
What's the worst?
Out.
Okay. What's the worst refugee crisis have you ever seen, and why was it worse?
Okay. The worst refugee crisis I have seen, and it broke my heart, is Bosnia. Because the one thing I met, not only famine, not only war, it's not only displacement, it's famine, it's war, displacement, imprisonment, and systemized rape. Organized rape. Thousands and thousands and thousands of girls and women have been raped. Systematically. This broke our heart. And it was so close to us in the middle of Europe. Nobody could imagine that this would happen. You can imagine a famine in Africa. You can imagine a flood or earthquake somewhere. Okay? But you cannot imagine that people in Europe have this kind of ugly feeling towards the neighbors. We used to imprison girls. Well, they come 5 months or 6 months pregnant and release them after. And it was called now concentration. This was the worst. You have not seen it. It was 1992 to 1995. Okay? This is the worst for me. Thank you. Alaikum Assalam. I can't come to you.
I wanted to ask, how can we get more non-Muslims involved in experiences like this, like we've had this weekend? Because, I mean, obviously, there's a lot of looking around, there are majorities, most of us are Muslims, so it's, I think it would have been better had we maybe put a bit more of an awareness, maybe had some non-Muslims here today, so they could actually see that maybe these Muslims maybe do the prostitution.
There was a photographer here. Where is the photographer?
He's gone.
He's gone.
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't Alhamdulillah.
Yeah, okay. You become a good Muslim. Being a Muslim, and the good Muslim will attract many non-Muslim to come to you because they are working in Islamophobic time, and a lot of Islamophobes are actually preventing people from seeing the good picture of Islam. Okay, this is number one. How I'm good to my next door neighbor so he can give me his son or his daughter to travel with me for a weekend. See, if he does not trust you and you are his next door neighbor, will never give you. Because the first non-Muslim who will come to give you his daughter or his son is your neighbor or your friend in the school, in the university, or whatever it is. So if I am a good Muslim and trusted by those people, non-Muslim, of course they'll be important. Of course they'll get. I remember during the earthquake of Iran, 1991, the flood Sudan, and Sudan 1989, and the flood in Bangladesh as well. A lot of churches came at that time to donate to Islamic Relief in Mosley Road. In Mosley Road, and raising fund for Islamic Relief in Mosley Road. Let's see, 25 years ago. Why are you going back? Why are you going back? Why are you become more? The people who live in ghetto, what do you call them? Ghetto keeper? No, ghetto residents. Why you go back? Okay. Why you become entrenched in our locality and separating ourselves from the cold, the beautiful cold weather? You like the cold weather? So. Your message is beautiful. You remember when I was talking last this year about share your relief? That's right. What did I say? Share your belief. This was before Ramadan in Birmingham. We don't share our belief with others. They don't know who are we. We're aliens. You know the alien who come from the space? You look like one of them.
Thanks.
No, I'm looking like one of them.
It's all right.
Thank you.
A lot of charities around.
Okay.
Like EPPL, Islam Relief, doing good. But then for my, if you have combined them only one.
No. They've got many prophets came to address humanity differently at different times. Your likeness could be for Islamic Relief. My likeness could be for Muslim Aid. Or for human appeal or for us. What you need to do is to coordinate their work and let them to sit down together. Let them to sit down together and save the time and save the money of their spending on administration. Okay. But actually, I cannot tell the public, I cannot tell you, sir, not to resist an organization. It's a part of my duty as citizen. It's about my social responsibility to my community and my society and my country to organize some social activity, some humanitarian activity. But actually, those hundreds of organizations are coming out now. They have to sit down together to understand that they have to coordinate the work to minimize the expenditure. And this is a challenge. It's a big challenge. That's what we are doing it to an organization called Muslim Charities Forum, which is Islamic Relief, Human Appeal, Muslim Aid, Islamic Help, Muslim Hands, okay? Orphans in Need. Now Africa Relief is coming, and others are coming. Those are sitting together for the last 6 or 7 years. That's what you need to do. Thank you.